Welcome to the session Artificial Intelligence from Science Fiction to Reality, where we are going to have a conversation with representatives from the public and private sector. My name is Gretel Schach, and I'm today with Philip Riegebauer, my colleague, to moderate this discussion with great insights from three representatives from the public and private sector, having a conversation about strategies, challenges, opportunities around the use of AI and best practices for cities. Philip and I work at Babel, which is a spin-off of the Fraunhofer Institute in Germany. We work, our purpose is to improve urban life and to really drive the change for a better urban life. And we do that by bridging the gap between the private and public sector and also supporting knowledge sharing exchange through our smart city platform and community, as well with consultancy and building capacity through the training. This is the context why we have set this conversation. We want to advance the conversation about AI, show the great examples that some cities are doing, and they are advancing the conversation as well with the private sector and the current developments that exist. And we have seen in the past years an explosion of the utilization of AI. We have seen several applications that are being used for monitoring traffic, improving the flow of transit in cities, the use or counting the use of masks during the pandemic, also measuring busyness in cities, in the city center, especially for chatbots and different applications that public and private sector have been using, developing and enhancing in the past years. At the same time, there has been some criticism to some of the applications that have been implemented. Some in the cases of using these applications for the justice systems to assess whether a person should go back to jail or not, their possibility to reincidence, using some places are also banning the use of facial recognition and trying to preserve the privacy of people. There have been some concerns around some medical use, or you may also remember criticisms to an Amazon tool that was used to recruit people and that had some bias against women in particular. So there has been some criticism, but at the same time, there are several governments, especially local governments around the world, that are taking a stance and moving forward with different ways to address those challenges presented by different parts of society, addressing those criticisms, as well as the risk that may come along with the use of AI and really enhancing its use to make sure that AI is put to good use. We can see, for example, the case of Amsterdam, where they have implemented this registry where they give information about how AI systems are used in different public services, for mobility, for medical uses, and how is the data used, how are the risks assessed and addressed, and who are responsible for these systems. Also in the past years, we saw how New York formed a task force that will address and assess all the different AI systems that were being used by the city. Whether that was successful or not, that's a different story. But we do see movement from public government to really move forward and regulate the use of AI, making sure that it's put to good use. And similarly, we have also seen lately the launch of the strategy from Barcelona to make use that AI is used in an ethical manner also from public sector. This is a bit the context that we are looking at. And that is why we have all these great speakers today to have this conversation on strategies, developments, opportunities, challenges, and best practices for cities. So today we have three speakers. We have Johannes Cruz, who is the data analyst from the Data Information and Insight team from the Greater Helsingborg area. We also have Michael Donaldson, who is the Commissioner for Technological Innovation, E-Government, and Good Governance from Barcelona City Council. And we also have Imre Gustav Bellama, board member of Ritech, one of the top 50 EU prop tech company from Estonia. So thank you very much for joining us today. It's a pleasure to have you, three of you, in our panel and be part of this conversation. I've been following your work and seeing the great activity that you have been doing around the use of AI, different projects, strategies. But I think it's now a good opportunity to also tell the audience how you have been involved in the use of AI, strategies-wise, or the application of it. And maybe you could also share some nice examples, good examples that show maybe a specific project that created some positive impact for society. Maybe, Johannes, you could start sharing your experience in this case.
Well, as a data scientist, I'm involved in AI projects within the city of Helsingborg from start to finish. A lot of the time is spent on the data itself to ensure well-executed deliveries. The better the data, the better the AI solution. So we predict food waste on our public schools. This includes both the waste that isn't even served to the students and the food the students themselves throw away. So this helps us plan for better recipes, but also to correct the quantity we cook at the schools. Another example I have is our speaking robot, Emily. So we have this immigrant group further away from the job market, and they can come and practice their Swedish in an interview situation with Emily. And we hope it will prepare them for real-life interviews and increase their chance for landing a job. So those are some examples.
Thank you very much. That's fascinating, also the different applications, and I hope that also inspires some action from the viewers and the audience. Michael, I know also Barcelona has been using AI, and you have been involved as commissioner in some of these activities. What can you tell us about it?
Yeah, thanks. Thanks a lot, Gretel. Well, to be honest, we are just kind of starting using AI, as it's not really an emerging technology because it's been going on for the last 40, 50 years. But we can say that using it at the public level, as a public services, we are just starting to use it now. We've got a little bit of experience, for example, last year with all the COVID problems, and we wanted to guarantee the social distance when the people went to the beach on the summertime. You know, Barcelona, we've got 5 kilometers of coast. We've got good weather all along the summer, spring, and into autumn. So there's a lot of people, tourists, but also a lot of people from Barcelona using the beach. And especially after the lockdown in 2020, we wanted to guarantee the distance, the social distance between the people that went to the beach. And so we had kind of a cameras that they were monitoring the whole time, which was the density, and that we use AI intelligence in order to calculate this distance between the people. But it was very important to say, and that's something that we work very keen on it, that these cameras, they weren't recording because we wanted to guarantee the privacy. They were just analyzing and giving us on real time which was the density between the people in the beach. So we were able to send that information to on the website. That sense, people would decide if it was good enough to go down to the beach or if it was too crowded. And at the same time, it gave us information in order to close the beach if there was too many people in the beach at the same time. It was very important, as I said, that these cameras, they were just kind of having real-time the information, but not recording people in order to guarantee their privacy. And we also been using the AI on a website in order to give information to our citizens if they want to apply for public services, as especially for subsides or economic helps. You put your information, what's your situation, how many children you've got, where do you live, what kind of incomes you've got, what kind of needs you have, and the website gives you back all the subsides and economic helps that the city hall can provide you according to your profile.
It's fascinating to see like the different applications and how also adaptable that could be to the situation, for example, in the case of COVID and maintaining the distance between each other. Imre, I know you're also involved from maybe a different sector, and I want to hear from you how is that and how it plays for you.
Thank you, and hello, everybody. So actually, I would like to start with a history, and is probably my first strong touch with artificial intelligence. So maybe you remember 1997, when Deep Blue was the first computer beating world champion in chess, Garry Kasparov. And of course, since that, artificial intelligence has been developed very strongly, and today artificial intelligence is able to run factories, cars, buildings, and a lot of more, like you have mentioned already. And yes, today I am representing RA Technologies, and we are developing and we use artificial intelligence to take commercial buildings, technical management to the next generation. So it means that the operational efficiency of very complex technical systems inside big buildings is increased tremendously by using computational power for analysis, calculations, and even the most remarkable for actions. And just one example from one 25,000 square meters commercial building, office building in Tallinn, in Estonia. So it has, for example, 3,000 controllable heating, ventilating, and cooling components. It has about 50,000 data points. So it is clear that no human operator, even not the best human operators teams, are able to run these systems the most efficient way. But the artificial intelligence is able to do it. And if we come back to this example, so our artificial intelligence made over 500,000 set point changes in 4 months. And it resulted about 30% energy savings and improvement of indoor climate from 60% level to 90% level. So this is just the difference between artificial intelligence and humans. So if you like it or not, so it doesn't matter too much.
Okay, thank you very much. Great initiatives you are doing, and thanks for sharing. To move directly to the next question, we know that Barcelona is implementing a data strategy, can you explain it for us a bit, and also in regards to the idea to maximize the social benefit of AI?
Yeah, sure, Philip. Thanks for the question. We launched last year our data strategy basically on the idea of the data as a common good, such as many others common goods, and especially being very keen on privacy issues. I mean, we want to, as a public body, as a public institution, to gather all the data in order to take better decisions and to provide with better services. Now, we've just launched last June our strategy on AI, and we want to go a little bit further up. Gathering all this data, it's okay to know the situation, and especially when the information is good enough to have this information in real time. But what we want to do, combining the big data, or what we call the good data, with the AI, is to pass from this idea of a reactive administration to a more proactive administration. So instead of waiting for people to come and ask for different public services, we should be able to get in touch with our citizens, because we know what are their needs based on their profiles, based on the data when we gather it, so we can deliver better public digital service in a more proactive way. Let me just put an example. It might be too simple and it's not exactly the same, but it gives us a good idea. We all know the way Netflix sends us an email on Friday night saying, based on what you've seen, you might like to see this movie or this TV show or wherever. So we're kind of talking about a service in that sense, based on the needs, based on what you like, based on what you need. Here's a different public digital service that we can provide you, because we've known for a fact at the European level that over 30% of the economic subsidies provided by the different public institutions are lost because the people who are potential to have them, they don't even know that they exist. So this is a great inefficiency that it gives us, leads us to a great inequality. And we, if we've got the tools and AI and good data should give us the good tools, we should be providing a better public services, better public policies.
Thank you. Maybe it makes sense to directly ask Johannes for the perspective of Helsingborg to add something.
Definitely, thank you. Well, a city administration has a lot of data, so some data is heavier regulated than other. So we have GDPR and other local Swedish regulations. We have an open data platform where we publish the data the city of Helsingborg can make public. So we hope that this can facilitate for external parties to innovate on the data and hopefully improving the lives of our citizens. And the more and better data we can make public, the more democratic the digital scene will become. Perhaps with hackathons or other forms of competitions, we can find new AI solutions that will lead to societal benefits in our city. And our healthcare administration has a test environment for AI solutions, where external parties can come and try things and ideas in a real environment with real data. And this can come to expand by the use of synthetic data, which will enable sensitive data to become more available for more people, leading to more AI being tested on it.
Thank you. Imre, as we heard now, the public sector, so can you see you add something from the private sector?
Sure, in a private sector, there is a lot, but the way I would just like to say is that if we speak about positive impact of artificial intelligence, I think that every technology has a kind of positive impact of, or at least the goal of every new technology is to have positive impact. That is the main reason why to develop this new technology. And I'm sure that all these like different types of positive impact can be very different. So it can really be like increasing safety or increasing efficiency or opening totally new opportunities and so on. And for example, if we speak about our solution, so our digital operator again, so we are focusing on three main KPIs to increase or improve by our artificial intelligence. So these are energy efficiency, indoor climate, and building's technical condition. And of course, the more different KPIs you can follow at the same time, the better it is. For example, if we speak about energy efficiency itself in buildings, it is very easy. So just turn everything off and you are able to save 100% of energy. This is not a question at all. But of course, all the people would escape from these buildings because it wouldn't be healthy, safe and comfortable to stay there anymore. So it's really important to focus more just than one topic because buildings, because life itself is a complex thing.
Okay, thank you. What we already learned, I think, is was that artificial intelligence is a truly revolutionary achievement of computer science. And we heard a lot about opportunities. And but we want to also discuss the challenges directly. And so I will hand over to my colleague Peter now for the next question.
I think also, Michael, you started to elaborate a bit on that, also making sure that, for example, these cameras are not collecting private information or the faces, recording the faces of people. And I would just like to hear from you, what do you think are maybe the biggest challenges for AI policy? Where do they lie? And maybe just to give an example of it.
Yeah. I don't know if it's the main challenge, but it's a big one. It's a huge one from the public point of view, the ethics that surround the use of AI. Because we're living in very complex times, and there's a lot of technology going on. I mean, there's, and especially after the lockdown with the hyper digitalization, we are living really a lot of new technologies, a lot of use, a lot of things that most of them we don't even understand them. I mean, every time WhatsApp goes on an update, my mother rings me, and do I have to click it? Do I have to accept it? Are they going to charge me money? So, I mean, most of the regular people, we don't even know what how many technologies are going. But what we know from the public perspective is to guarantee the rights of our citizens and to fight against no discrimination. So we've learned a lot of potential and a lot of good things that AI and other emerging technologies bring us, and even Gustav was pointing some of them. We know what the benefits that that technology brings us. So we are of course not saying no, we don't want technology because it's got a risk, but we know that it brings risks. We've seen what happened in England, in UK, with the A-levels, with the lockdown, they decided to use AI and algorithms to see what were the marks from the students, because they weren't able to go to do their exams, so they just took the background from their academic marks, but also from the schools that they were studying. So we saw a lot of discrimination because a lot of students had good marks, but when they were combined with the school centers, they had worse marks, and so they weren't able to choose the career they wanted. There was such an unrest on the streets that they have to bring back this use of AI. We've seen as well some discrimination. You were pointing it at the beginning with the selection of human resources. So we know there's a lot of possibility of risks on discrimination and not using it in an ethic way. The way we use the data, what we do with that data, where if we share it or not. So there's a lot of risks in that sense. And this is, as I said, one of our challenges. And this is why when we launch our initiative, our strategy on AI, since the beginning, we also brought in some guarantees in order to fight against discrimination and in order to guarantee all the digital rights, because nowadays reality and virtual and digital is all mixed up. So it's not only, we cannot talk about only anymore about human rights, but we also have to talk about human digital rights.
Okay, thank you. Because the time is ticking very fast, so we would move to maybe the last question now, and also ask especially Imre and Johannes for their perspective on a recommendation for cities, if other cities want to start a process to implement artificial intelligence, and what you can give them on their way as a recommendation. Johannes, maybe you start.
Okay, thank you. Yeah. Well, from my point of view, AI is a mean and not an end. We need more means for the benefit of our cities. So for someone who wants to start using AI, I think it's really important to not look at it as something standalone, but to think broader and see if AI could be included in something we already are about to do. AI should be our wingman and not the focal point. Another thing is that an innovative culture is important when you want to explore new alternatives and methods. We need to try and fail many times. We need to explore data and see what can be done to consume it in new ways. Could AI enhance or improve existing processes? Is it possible to start collecting data currently not being collected, for example? And also, I'd like to emphasize the importance of establishing support from high-level bosses and local politicians. I think that without this, no initiative will go very far or be put into real and lasting production, I'd say.
Thank you. Imre, do you want to add something?
Yes, I absolutely agree with Johannes. So first of all, there should be like a clear understanding about bottlenecks or a vision for a new opportunity that needs really artificial intelligence. And for the second, of course, it's very important to involve all the stakeholders inside the organization. This is like a new project related to artificial intelligence. Of course, it slows down any process at the beginning, but as a result, it helps a lot if people are part of the process. And we have several experiences, including with very motivated city governments, where just some levels are not involved, some levels don't have kind of motivation, and as a result, it would be kind of waste. So avoiding and removing stakeholders' no's is not easy, but of course, it's very important.
So thank you very much for this interview. It's time is ticking, so I want to already thank the, all the speakers for sharing your experiences. I think it was especially interesting to also hear the different perspective from the private and public sector, and we hope that this multilateral discussion also leads to better applications and you continue this kind of discussions. We have one more thing on the next slide. It's that we also want to ask our audience or to give the audience the chance to share their thoughts. So you can just tell us your in-view or also just rate how much benefits you see in for AI. And it's super quick. You just have to use the QR code there or go to slido.com and use the event code Babel. And the good thing is the results are, we will just discuss right after the session, and the link you will find in the festival program, where we also have the chance to have interaction together. So, and we will present the results. So now it's time already to close the session. Once again, thank you for the speakers and for your time and for your interviews and your practical examples you gave us. Also, we wish the audience much more insights at the Creative Bureaucracy Festival. And you are welcome to join the discussion as told in the interactive session with Slido and share your thoughts. And we also recommend to have a look to the Babel platform. It's www.babel-smartcities.eu. And we have a platform where you can find a lot of use cases in regards to artificial intelligence from European cities. And the good thing is it's free to use, so have a look there. And last, you can, of course, get in contact with us if you have further questions or challenges you want to have solved. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Okay. See you now. Thanks a lot.
Thanks, and we'll see you.